I'm Chris Flinn. I'm at the New York University Department of Economics. I was a graduate school a student of Jim Heckman's. Left here quite a while ago. Before that, I had a career in sociology, that in population studies mainly. So there was a lot of continuity in my interests. I was interested basically in income inequality determination, schooling decisions, and so on. I just found that economics afforded me more of an opportunity to use models, more formal models, behavioral models, to investigate these phenomena. And on the basis of estimated versions of these models, to be able to do various kinds of counterfactual policy experiments. I've got two main areas of research, and some recent projects that combine the two to some degree. One is job search. That was some of my initial research with Jim, estimating search models that before then had been basically just theoretical. Mm-hmm. How do you take those models to data? What can you do with the estimates of those? How can you decompose factors behind inequality in terms of opportunities, rates of meeting potential employers, discrimination possibly, which is kind of ironic because one of the papers being given here tomorrow is joint with Petra Todd, another of his students, and it essentially uses a souped up version of that kind of framework to actually look at gender differentials in a search framework with bargaining differences, while accounting, the novelty in that is accounting for psychological characteristics between males and females. So we can find things like women tend to be more agreeable than men. That helps in terms of our estimates, that helps in terms of rates of contacts, but hurts you in bargaining, which has been documented in lots of studies at various levels of formality. And our estimates kind of bear that out. This is just using German data. So it's hard to find very good data sets that have these personality characteristics, detailed information on job market outcomes, and so on. So, you know, that remains one of the big challenges of doing any of this kind of research is data availability limitations, which I remember Jim always complaining about how lack of data was a fundamental problem, and the profession didn't incentivize people to invest in collecting data. So there's so much secondary analysis. Now there's field experiments and so on, but those aren't as involved as collecting big representative national samples that people can use for decades afterwards. Yeah, I think the work in developmental psychology has had a big effect on my work and Jim's. So we have a slightly different style in the way we approach child development issues. That was my other area I neglected to go into, but I've been working on child development and household economics more generally. There's a good group of developmental psychologists at NYU who Jim knows well too. And so I've spoken to them often. Their ideas have influenced me a lot. However, it's kind of interesting, the sociology of these fields, the academic fields. I could probably never write a paper with them, and they could never write a paper with me. Even if we can talk about issues and understand perfectly, it's just the way they write shorter papers. We write more novellas that are supposed to have, you know, a storyline to them, and they write short papers that they get published quickly. They don't really have working paper series. They just get them out quickly. They're 10 pages long, copious number of citations. So I've learned a lot from the developmental psychologists and sometimes economic historians once in a while, but mainly developmental psychologists, I guess.